So good morning, everybody, and welcome to worship. This is our first day practicing hybrid worship, a possible format going forward. So we're joined by a live studio audience of three people and everybody here on Zoom. And Ray's here too. So that's four. So friends, Jesus taught that love is the center of everything. It's that to which the whole of Scripture points. It's the only worthwhile measure of our lives. It's the only thing that can change us and our world for the better. And so our work today is the same as it is every day, and that is to ground our lives more and more in that love. So whoever you are, wherever you are, whether you're here in the live studio audience, lucky you, or whether you're joining us on Zoom, however you are in your spirit, whatever you may have done in the course of your life or just the course of this week, you are welcome here, and we are so glad to have you with us this morning. There's just two announcements I want to bring to your attention. And that is, the first is that our Faith After Doubt book discussion group continues on Zoom this week, Wednesday at 7, starts at 7. Check your mailbox for a link to that. It's a fun and easy and good read, so this will be our third session. You can still catch up if you want to join. So we invite you to buy that, join in. The people who've been coming are getting a lot out of it so far. And then secondly and lastly, we have our bag distribution for our Thanksgiving food drive, Saturday, November 13th at 10 a.m. We need to distribute 1,000 bags around the Hillside neighborhood. And the reason it's called the Hillside neighborhood is that there's a lot of steps. It's on a hill. We need a lot of people to distribute those bags. So if you have the energy and are looking to get good leg workout, we invite you to join us for that. Are there any other words of announcements? And actually, kids, you actually get to start downstairs today. Sorry about that. So without further ado, we have our opening song, an original by our very own Luke Concannon.
People who just yet to be. that you're our expertise. We are the people who are yearning for some vision transformed into such faith. Then get on with some kissing.
Together, let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Use the words that work for you, our Father and Mother who art in heaven. Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, it's time for our special meal where we eat bread and we drink juice together. If you're here with us, there are some elements going around the sanctuary. If you're at home, we invite you to get some bread and some juice-like drink at this moment as I go get our own. Friends, we'd like to tell a story about how on the night before he died, Jesus was sitting at a table with his friends, And after he had given thanks to God, he took bread and he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Whenever you do this," he said, "remember me." After the same manner, he also took the cup and said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, poured out for one and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this," he said, "remember me." So friends, as is our tradition, I invite you to warm up your blessing hands, hold them over your bread, over your juice, as I pray that God's blessing be upon them. Gentle Redeemer, there is no limit to your blessing and no end to your grace. Send your spirit of life and love, power and blessing upon every table where your children shelter in place, that this bread may be broken and gathered in love, and this cup poured out to give hope to all. Risen Christ, live and breathe in us, that we may live and breathe in you. Amen. And now, friends, take, eat. This is the body of Christ broken for you. And now, friends, take, drink. This is the blood of Christ poured out for all. And would all God's people say, amen?
Amen.
Amen. So this morning, we continue on with our Sermon on the Mount series, and today's reading comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 25 through 34. I invite you to listen for the word of God in these words of scripture. "Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat?' or 'What shall we drink?' or 'What shall we wear?' For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." Friends, here ends our reading. May we be blessed with understanding.
Thank you so much, musicians. I'm going to make those of you who are not able to be with us this morning jealous to say that from the beginning to this moment, the piano, the music, the voice, it's just been such a blessing. So thank you. And thank you, God. Let us pray. Winds blow, rains fall, storms rage, especially this week. And God, you are our strength and our sanctuary. Floods rise, waves batter, wars ravage. And God, you are our strength and our sanctuary. Violence threatens, hunger abounds, disease flourishes. And God, you are our strength and our sanctuary. And worry abounds, God. Yet you are our strength and sanctuary. We are safe here in this spirit place, for God's sustaining and nourishing spirit surrounds us and affirms us and guides us. Help us, Holy One, to stand in your strength and sanctuary as we seek guidance and direction and holiness. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Whistle with me. I know we're not supposed to. Do you remember? The whimsy of its message notwithstanding, this 1988 hit single, Don't Worry, Be Happy, and the comedic video that followed, starring singer-songwriter of that song, Bobby McFerrin, Robin Williams, and Bill Irwin, suggests that worry can just be turned off and happiness turned on through the exercise of one's will. The antics displayed in the music video would have us simply turn our frowns upside down with some special friends, silly costumes, and a commitment to a smile. How many of you had a don't worry, be happy yellow iconic smiley button or a poster in the late 80s? It's true that friends and connection to community and the funnies and dancing and singing can all positively affect our energy and our attitudes. I know I'm not alone in having anecdotal evidence that acting as if actually has its benefits. And when you smile, your brain releases tiny molecules called neuropeptides that help fight off stress. And then other neurotransmitters like dopamine and serotonin and endorphins come into play as well. So there is evidence that forcing a smile, Reverend Tom, can bring you a boost in mood and happiness level. Don't worry, be happy. I don't know. The trouble that I have with this wisdom is the idea of dependence on my will as the solution to worry and happiness, because worry and happiness are tied to my thinking and my feelings and ultimately my entire spiritual condition. And man, oh man, left to my own devices, left to my will, my ideas, my plan, my mind, and my thinking, well, there, in my mind, I'm hanging out in dangerous territory, are you? Mainly in the territory of the human condition and ego. Don't worry, be happy can work for a time, but is this an effective life hack for the long haul? Needless to say, in our reading today, Jesus flips the switch and suggests another approach. Don't worry, be holy. So today, in our fourth and final sermon of this season's Sermon on the Mount series, let's consider how a single-minded devotion toward God and God's kingdom might be the real antidote to worry. I don't know about you, but when I'm worrying, it sounds like this swirling in my head. Na 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 na. And if I succumb to it, it goes on, and it blocks out everything else. Na 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 na. Can anybody identify with that? And then it's all about me, about being up here in my thinking and my ego, and not being in God, not being in service of use to others, not being in alignment with love. Think about how much impact worry has in our lives. And yet Jesus asks, can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to the span of your life? That question is as timely today as when Jesus posed it 2,000 years ago. Does worrying do us any good? It would be good to know the answer to that question, because Lord knows we put huge amounts of time and energy into worrying about all sorts of things that might happen, most of which never actually come to pass. And life is generous in providing a cornucopia of possible problems in which we can invest our angst. Yet, having burned through all that anxiety, what do we have to show for it? Have we, as Jesus asked, added a single hour to our lives? Certainly, since Jesus asked that question rhetorically, he intended for his audience to answer it in their minds with a resounding no, absolument no. But if you're at all human, another possible answer may occur to you, and that is, who knows? For instance, if one is a worrier and dies at the age of 68 years, 114 days, and 17 hours, who's to say that without all that fretting, they would have lived to be only 68 hours, 114 days, and 16 hours? Did their worry gain them an hour? How can we possibly know? Well, of course, by setting up a study and using scientific methods, that's how. The results of one such study can be found in the December 2006 Mayo Clinic Proceedings Medical Journal. As far as we know, the researchers did not have Jesus's point in mind, that worry cannot add even a single hour to one's life. Yet, the study's conclusion suggests that Jesus was right, and it reveals a surprising flip side to that argument, suggesting that not being a chronic worrier can add not only an hour, but perhaps even years to your lifespan. It actually began back in the 60s when some 7,000 students at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill took the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory, a test that, among other things, measured the participants' tendency to be optimistic or pessimistic. Of that group, 1,600 or so were found by the test to be clearly pessimists, and about 1,000 to be clearly optimists. The rest fell somewhere in the middle of a continuum. Over the next four decades, 400 and almost 500 of those who had taken the test died from causes ranging from accident to illness to suicide to homicide. By tracking and collecting and collating all this information, researchers determined that the pessimists had a significantly greater likelihood of dying sooner from any cause than did the optimists. As the dry language of the findings report put it, those who scored as pessimistic had decreased rates of longevity compared with optimistic individuals. It also said the current results replicate in a non-medical sample those of earlier studies that suggest that optimism is associated with increased survival. So to bring this back to where we started, worrying isn't likely to even add an hour to your life. Get rid of the worry and you'll likely live longer. Of course, pessimism and worry are not exactly identical. Pessimism is the tendency to take a gloomy view of life and assume that most things ultimately drift or march toward negative outcomes. Worry is a mental and emotional response of concern or even fear to vague or unspecified threats. To describe the difference another way, we could say that pessimism is an outlook about things in general, and worry is a response to particular possibilities. Yet at root, both pessimism and worry are related to a shortage of hope and trust. Pessimism, which has no confidence that things will work out, can breed despair, and that word literally means unhope. Despair. Unhope. In the New Testament reading where Jesus poses this question about adding to our span through worry, he went on to make clear that what he was calling for instead was for us to trust God. He pointed to the birds that do not sow or reap the fields, but are fed by the heavenly creator nonetheless. He pointed to the flowers that do not toil or spin, but are clothed in beauty by the heavenly creator anyway. It's critical to understand, however, that his words were directed to people who did have to sow, to reap, to toil, and to spin, and he wasn't telling them to stop doing those things. He simply wanted them to understand that their lives were a lot more like the sum of their sowing, reaping, were a lot more than the sum of their sowing, reaping, toiling, spinning, or the likes on their Facebook profile. Further, Jesus tied the call to not worry to the kingdom of God. But strive first for the kingdom, he says. Strive first for the kingdom of God and God's righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. That's a significant linkage because God's kingdom is the ultimate reason for optimism and hope. The very meaning of the kingdom is that God and those who stand with God triumph. In the end, good is victorious over evil. Don't get me wrong here, as a citizen of God's kingdom, as a follower of Jesus, as a child of God's beloved creation, as one who turns to the Holy Spirit for guidance, it is still possible that you might worry about human activity in the short term. I mean, we are human beings, right? But you've got every reason to be optimistic about God's activity in the long term. As an aside, it might be helpful here to think about the kingdom of God, not in terms of a place or a space or as something that comes later, but as Jesus calls it, a kingdom within you. It's within you. Thus, from within us, we experience the kingdom of God in relationship with God. The rule of God becomes our guidance system. The authority of God is over our choices, our will, our mind. To be a citizen of God's kingdom, then, is to recognize God's right to be the formative and final voice for the decisions that we make in faith and in practice. Talk about a reason to be optimistic. Thy will, not mine, be done. In fact, on another occasion, Jesus made that very point in John 16. In this world, you will have trouble. You will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. And what does take heart mean other than be optimistic? In fact, the King James Version words it as be of good cheer. So by bringing the kingdom of God into the discussion, Jesus reminds us that in the longest haul, we who follow him have nothing to worry about. Don't worry, be holy, for you are a citizen of the kingdom. Well, there you have it, sermon over. Over the long haul, you have nothing to worry about. Yeah? Are we done? Or does anybody have any objections? Let's back this train up into the station just for a minute. We've got some objections that make it hard for us to go along with Jesus on this. Objection one, the things most of us worry about are not long-term issues at all. While these days more and more of us are aware, for instance, of the issue and concern, most of us don't live our day-to-day in joy-crushing anxiety over how global warming will affect us. Although millennials seem to be a little bit more sensitive to that, yes? Day to day, we don't fret about how or when the world will end. The well-being of our community, neighbors, families, and selves in the midst of a pandemic notwithstanding, most of our concerns are over shorter-term issues like, will I get a good report from the doctor this time? Or will my kids stay out of trouble? Or am I being a good parent? Or will I be able to pay my bills if my job is outsourced overseas? While many of us are not pessimists by inclination, we can be pessimistic in the dire possibilities that our worries ask us to brood about. Objection number two, We might argue that normal anxiety, unavoidable worry that comes to almost everyone, is a good thing. It supports our taking action, right? If everyone feels normal anxiety from time to time, then surely we should not feel guilty about it. Further, normal worry causes us to take preventative measures against potential problems and even energizes us to make some significant and constructive changes in the way we live. It's natural to feel our vulnerability to the forces of nature, to sickness and to death, and we ought not feel guilty about that either. Objection number three, Jesus is so logical in this passage, too logical. It's the very height of reasonableness for him to say, in effect, since you trust God that all things will ultimately work out for good, and since you trust that God cares for you, and even more, that God cares for birds and flowers, you therefore should not worry about what you will eat or what you will drink or what you will wear. Yeah, right. Unfortunately, logic does not rule the human condition. We are not wired that way. We cannot neatly compartmentalize anxiety and then talk ourselves out of it. Some worry tends to occur despite logical reasoning, for it's wrapped up in our emotions that are wrought from our thinking. And so it chatters at us, saying this may not work out or that could fall short and so-and-so may slip up. I may have not anticipated every contingency. Whatever can go wrong probably will. Our minds keep processing those thoughts over and over, building up dread and leaving us uneasy. So we've got objections to being told not to worry. So let's go back for a minute to our own experience of worry. My 12-step sponsor says that worry is a prayer for a bad outcome. Worry starts in our mind. It's a thought pattern, and thoughts can be changed. But you've got to put the worry on the altar for it to be altered. You cannot keep it in your hands, grasping it, holding on to it for dear life, nurturing it and playing with it, keeping it up here in that na-na-na-na-na-na-na space of the mind and the emotions. If you're going to give it up, you've got to let it go. Open up your hands and surrender it to the power outside of yourself. You see, God cannot take from you what you will not let go. Can I get an amen to that? Our thoughts can be healed, but we have to be willing to be healed. And you cannot do that letting go, that surrendering to the healing hand of the Holy alone. You can't, and God can. Our human problem with worry is that we think our thoughts can figure it all out. We think that with the power of the will, using our little p human power rather than a big P God power outside of ourselves, we can manage and control the outcomes of the world. And therefore, we worry about outcomes. But outcomes are not our business. They are God's business. And so we have to let go. We have to put it down. We have to turn to God in order for God to heal the worry. It's kind of like when you go to the restaurant, if you're still holding on to your fork, the waiter will not come and take the plate away when you've got, even if you're finished. If you're still consuming the worry, God can't take it away. God can't heal the worried thinking. So what if all these objections really tell us that we have missed the heart of what Jesus is talking about in this passage? This was not his dissertation on worry. He's not Dr. Phil giving us a prescription for how to avoid anxiety. His main point is this: strive first for the kingdom of God and God's righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well, as a result of. Yes, to strive means to exert an energy and effort toward a goal. So far from simply saying that we should rely on the eventual coming of God's kingdom as an antidote to daily worry, Jesus is saying that we should actively work for the spread of the kingdom. So in part, as we do, some of the things we fret about are going to become non-issues because we've got more important things to be busy with. Yes? None of this is to say that we won't therefore have some normal worries. We can't love someone without worrying about threats to their well-being. We can't be sensitive people without occasional concern that we haven't done all that we should. We can't listen to the news, engage in a cycle of elections, face America's racial reckoning, or walk through a global pandemic and all of its concomitant challenges to life, death, limb, security, without uneasiness about the direction that many things in the world appear to be going. But we can be focused enough on the things of God that we're able to relax about our priorities and have confidence in God's providential care. And that, beloved, is the definition of hope. You see, hope actually assumes that pessimists are sometimes right in the short run, but ultimately trust the long run view, and that confidence has a way of leaking back into our present circumstances. That's why instead of wringing our hands in despair, we clasp our hands in prayer. Dr. Edward Hallowell is a child and adult psychologist who taught at Harvard for more than 20 years and left academia to devote his full professional attention to his clinical practice, lectures, and the writings of books. Back in the 1990s, he was the one who brought attention to the attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, into the public awareness. But he also made a study of worry, which is the subject of one of his books. Writing about worry a way back in Psychology Today magazine, he offered several suggestions for dealing with excessive worry. But finally, he said this: talk to God when you feel worried. Brain scans and EEG monitors show beneficial change in the brain during meditation and prayer. The changes correlate with most of our measures of improved health, including longevity and reduce incidence of illness. In his book on worry, Hallowell revealed that he is a practicing Christian. And so in an interview with Psychology Today, the interviewer asked him if that admission was a risk for someone renowned in the psychiatric community. He acknowledged that it was a risk insofar as some people might dismiss him. But he added that he often advised patients to develop a spiritual life, and therefore felt it pretty important to acknowledge his own. And he said that spirituality is a very powerful part of the mind. He concluded, in my case, a relationship with God is another source of connection. And ultimately, it makes sense of my life in ways that nothing else can. You cannot add to your lifespan by worrying. But you likely will when you are open to the divine optimism that is rooted in God's kingdom and in God's love. It's connected to the long term, to be sure, but its power flows back to us in this moment, in the present, in the form of great confidence in God and energy to work for God's kingdom by spreading that optimism and love all over the place. Don't worry, be holy. Your spirit will thank you. May it be so.
I'm gonna treat everybody right.
treat everybody right. I'm gonna treat everybody right. I'm gonna treat everybody right till I die. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord till I die. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord till I die.
So friends, I'd like to invite you into a time of prayer, a time to lift up whatever joys or concerns may be on your heart this morning. If you are live here today, I invite you to just raise your hand. If you're on Zoom this morning, I'm going to need you to type your prayers into the chat box, and then I'll share them aloud on your behalf. After each prayer, we'll say, Lord, in your mercy, and I invite you all to say back, hear our prayer. And I want to begin with a prayer of thanksgiving. Last week, I lifted up a prayer for an outdoor church parishioner named Carol Simon, who had been in the hospital for 2 weeks with pneumonia. She got out this past Thursday after a long stay and is very glad to be out on her own. So prayer of thanksgiving for Carol. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. A prayer from Shelley Scruggs for continued grace and healing for many family members battling cancer and other illnesses. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Are there any other joys or concerns folks would care to lift up this morning? I want to lift up a prayer. You guys didn't get to see it. All the kids are downstairs in their Halloween costumes, looking pretty awesome. No doubt they will make out good tonight. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
I just want to lift up a prayer celebration. Those of you who were here a few years ago might remember helping Tom, who came to share wisdom with us. They are my three cousins, their siblings, and they're on this season of Voice. And they're going to the live rounds next week. But I just wanted to celebrate their talent, but also lift them up because this has been a really special experience for them. Their dad, my uncle,
So that's a prayer for Stephanie's cousins who were here a couple years ago, sang at our worship service. And I'm not saying that we made them, but they are now on The Voice, made it to the live rounds. So continue to hold them in our prayer, both for this special experience and for their family struggles. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We want to lift up a prayer for Nancy Sartanowicz, who is hospitalized with a respiratory illness. And for KE's friend Dan, who has Parkinson's, who is also at MGH with increasing cardiac symptoms. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And friends, this is, some of you know, every year at Hillside, we run a flu shot campaign. And for everybody who can say, I got a flu shot, our parish nurse will donate a certain amount to an organization that serves homeless in the local, in the area. I think, do we have, what's our count so far, Kathleen? We have 23 so far. I have my appointment this week, this Wednesday, to get mine. If you have one, let me know after the service. If you're on Zoom, let people know, let Kathleen know in the chat box. And hopefully we can have her write out a big old check to our friends at the Outdoor Church. Thank you so much, Kathleen. It's important stuff we do for our community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Prayer from Rachel Kay of Thanksgiving for kids' COVID shots being on the way. Amen. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. prayer for Jessica for her housing and job search, as well as for forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. I mentioned that one already. Yeah. Already got it. All right. If there are no other prayers, then friends, I invite you to join with me in a spirit of prayer. Holy, loving, and gracious God, we live in a world full of things that, for good reason, cause us to be anxious and cause us to worry. And hard though it is, God, help us trust and help us believe in your love that surrounds us each and every moment of our lives. And in those moments when we can't quite feel it, we can't see its impact in our lives and the world around us, God, help us lean on our community members. Help us lean on this church community, that they may hold that hope for us, that one day again we may feel your light shining on our faces and we may know again that you love us so, so much. And so God, trusting in that ever-presence, everlasting, ever-living love, we turn over to you all the prayers of our hearts, both those named today, both aloud and in our chat box, and those that go unnamed. Saying together, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen. And now for our final song, a traditional church hymn, Let It Be by the Beatles.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. In my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. When the broken hearted people living in the world agree, there will be an answer. Let it be. Though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they may see. There will be an answer. Let it be. Shine until tomorrow, let it be. I wake up to the sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be.
chorus.
Let it be, let it be, let it be.
We are so blessed, are we not? So blessed. What a blessing, what a blessing. Beloved, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and grant you peace. Go spread that kingdom attitude around. Your spirit will thank you. Amen.